Hello everyone, ahead on Business Live tonight, oil sector outlook. Ghana's oil reserves left with 2.5 billion barrels to be produced. That's if no new discoveries are made. Good news or bad news, we will discuss. Also ahead, another prediction for our economy, this time by Fitch Solutions. It is projecting a buoyant economy with expected growth rate of 4.8%. Plus, US-Africa ties under the Biden administration will tell you why AFTA could create a vast market for US businesses. Thanks for being with us. We've got details right after this break. Welcome back. Tonight, we're hearing Ghana's oil reserves are left with about 2.5 billion barrels more to be produced if new oil discoveries are not made. This represents about 86% of the total oil reserves. There's more in this report.
According to Fitch Solutions, only about 400 million barrels of oil so far been produced from the Jubilee and Tain fields since the country began oil production in the year 2011. This signifies ample opportunity for Ghana's upstream oil production. However, ongoing technical issues at both fields provide some risk to the country's oil production potential. Previous issues have meant output at the Jubilee and Tain fields is currently capped at 70% of maximum floating production, storage and offload capacity. Nonetheless, Tullow Oil's recent focus on improving water injection efficiency and optimizing wells is set to enhance the field's output over Fitch Solutions forecast period. This raises the prospect of increasing recoverable reserves at both the Jubilee and Tain fields. There are currently 49 injection and production wells at Jubilee and Tain fields planned between 2021 and 2030, with each production well projected to have an initial production rate of 10,000 to 15,000 barrels per day. Despite the company's ambitions, it is unlikely all wells will reach the desired initial production rates over the planned period, given the decline rates at the field. At the moment, the nation is still awaiting a boost from the Pecan field, which is expected to come on stream in 2025.
Well, joining me to discuss this further is Ishmael Ejekumhene, who is the Executive Director of the Institute, the Kumasi Institute of Technology and Environment. Great to speak with you tonight. It's been quite a while. Happy New Year, sir.
Many happy returns, Daryl.
All right. So we have 86% of our oil reserves yet to be produced until new discoveries are made. Do we treat this as good news?
Not quite. We've always known that oil is an inexhaustible resource. It's not renewable. So what you find and you continue to produce, the reserve is bound to get depleted. So we've always known, and I mean, when we found Jubilee, we knew that the industry wasn't going to last beyond 10 to 15 years if we were to produce at its full capacity. So it is a signal, and I think they are telling us what we should have known long ago, that if we don't make new discoveries, what we have found will get depleted, and then there will be no oil industry again.
All right, you talk about new discoveries. COVID-19 pandemic has slowed things in the oil and gas sector too. So what sort of challenge does it pose to discovering new reserves? Is there any challenge at all?
It does. I mean, what it has done, you know, the price of oil is a major determinant of how much money investors are prepared to pump into the industry. And when the prices are good, investors are prepared to invest. At the moment where the price is at the moment and the demand is so low, there's very little incentive for investments to go ahead. So exploration and development wells are all going to lag behind. So it has a direct impact in the sense that it's affecting demand and it's a disincentive to investments.
And these reserves that we have left, the 2.5 billion barrels, how do we manage that? I mean, and I don't know for how long that will last anyway. How do you manage that?
It depends on the rate at which we are bringing them from the reservoir. So if you're doing 100,000 barrels a day, assuming we're able to hit there, now we're around 70,000 because of all the challenges. You just multiply it by 365 and it tells you the volumes that we're going to lift in a year, and then you divide it by a number of years. It gives you a sense of how many more years we have to boast of this industry. So bottom line is that we really would want to maximize whatever returns that we're getting from the oil. So I think the investors are going to have to continue to recoup their investments and also maximize their returns on their investments. The real thing is we need to aggressively pursue exploration and make more discoveries. And those that have been discovered, we need to develop the fields before we can start talking about getting enough returns. But for the people who have already sunk money into the projects, they would want to recover their investment as quickly as possible so we can stop them. If all conditions are okay, they will continue to produce. And then if we don't make any new discoveries, we'll be left with no oil industry.
And how optimistic are you that there would be any new discoveries based on the challenges that we have right now?
Some discoveries have been made, but they need to finish with the appraisal and then the development of the well. So there are some projects in the pipeline that obviously would extend the lifespan of this industry. And new blocks have been issued. So we expect that they would also start aggressive exploration and make discoveries. We've proven that we have oil. So the fields that are being given now, the likelihood of striking oil is very high. But even when you've made a discovery, you have to develop the fields before you'll be able to get the oil out of there. But everybody who puts a cent into the ocean believes that they will make a discovery. And that's how we should all hope and trust that we're going to make more discoveries, possibly discoveries that are larger than the ones that we've found already.
You made an important point about maximizing the returns from the reserves that we have so far. How far have we done well, I should rather say, in maximizing the returns so far?
No, and I think we will be overflogging the issue if we start talking about the problem that we all know. We've said time and again that yes, we'll be able to tell Ghanaians that we've received over $5 billion. Bottom line is how the money has been utilized. Mm. And it's clear that in our attempt to solve virtually all our problems with the oil money, we've shared the money on small projects to the extent that there is very little to show. Not that maybe the money has been wasted, but yes, the way we've utilized the money, it's obviously led to a situation where, like we always say, we spread the funds so thinly, so we are unable to put a finger on what we've achieved. So unfortunately, over the past 10 years, we haven't been able to do a lot. And some of us have been advocating for legacy projects that we could decide and say that henceforth, we're going to use the money for this one project. And then so be it, and we find money for other things. But now we are trying to solve all our problems with oil money, and that's the reason why for the past 10 years we don't have a lot to show for what we have received so far.
And I guess that's what makes it more worrying, this report by Fitch, that we've been able to utilize 14% of our oil reserves, but there's nothing to show. And so what's going to happen with the 86%? Well, moving on, the Ghana Statistical Service releases petroleum price index for December 2020, which was pegged at negative 4%. So in terms of petroleum production, we dipped negative 4%. But that is a major improvement, Mr. Ejekumuhene, from the negative 15.4% recorded in May last year. I would say we are recovering, but with the pandemic raging again, I'm beginning to wonder what the outlook will be like for this year when it comes to petroleum production here in Ghana. What do you see?
Quite frankly, nobody knows what is going to happen. I mean, a lot will depend on how quickly the global economy is going to recover from the effects of the pandemic. And with what is raging in America and in Europe, once the winter is over, I don't think the outlook is that great. But I think the fact of the matter is that we are not producing an awful lot of barrels of crude. So our only challenge is the price. Otherwise, I'm sure 100,000 barrels, 120,000 barrels, some people will coolly take it off us and pay us. But what is happening is that once demand is low, we are unable to get good prices. When we started production, we were in some cases getting over $110 a barrel. Now it's averaging 56, 60%-ish, that kind of price range. And if your production is also low, then you're not getting enough revenue. So the outlook is still very volatile. You don't know what is going to happen, but we only have to position ourselves to make sure that we take advantage once the market is looking good. So for example, if demand is increasing and we still have challenges with our production wells, like the Jubilee and the FPSO, it means that we wouldn't be able to ramp up production to take advantage of increasing demand. But 2021 is still very unpredictable, and nobody knows whether we're going to do worse or better than we fared so far.
Unpredictable, that's true. Thanks so much for speaking with us tonight. That was Executive Director of Kite, Ishmael Ejekumhene. We'll still stay with Fitch's projections. Fitch Solutions, a research arm of Fitch, is also predicting a buoyant economy for Ghana this year with an expected growth rate of 4.8% as services and industry sectors recover sharply. The gross domestic product growth rate is almost in line with Moody's 4% projection, but in sharp contrast with the World Bank's 1.4%. In its latest Sub-Saharan Outlook report, senior country risk analyst at Fitch Solutions, William Atwell, said a boost in business and consumer spending will drive the nation's growth rate.
I mentioned in the presentation our GDP, real GDP growth expectations for 2021, fairly buoyant, expecting around 4.8%. That's following the slowdown to 1.3% is our estimate for 2020. Ghana, of course, experienced a technical recession in the middle part of last year, two consecutive quarters of contraction, Q2 understandably being the deeper of the two contractions, Q3 relatively shallow contraction, and the data that we've seen from the final months of the year does suggest that economic activity accelerated towards the end of the year. So we expect that Ghana exited the recession towards the end of last year. Looking ahead to this year, we're expecting pretty strong consumer spending.
Meantime, the director of the Institute of Statistical, Social and Economic Research, Professor Peter Kwote, is optimistic the economy grew by as much as 2% last year. The economy recorded a recession in the third quarter of the year, largely due to the impact of COVID-19 pandemic on many subsectors. But Professor Kwote is confident the economic recovery has been fairly good, and its impact will be seen in the fourth quarter gross domestic product figures.
Access to credit for some of these firms is a problem because the cost of credit is high. It's quite recently that it's come below 20% thereabout, but it's around 32%. And what kind of business can you do that you'll be able to recover your cost and then also pay 32% on it as well, and so on and so forth. But then luckily these days, we've had other schemes that are supporting agro-processing. So GESA, for instance, gives 70% credit guarantee to firms within the sector. Once that guarantee is given, any of the banks are willing to lend to you. There's also credit guarantee scheme. There's also the CAPBUS, that is the Coronavirus Alleviation Fund, that is being run by National Board for Small Scale Industry. So these are all things that are to help promote industrial production, agro-processing, etc. We saw that we had a positive significant growth in the first quarter of 2020. Then second and third quarter, we had a recession. But then it's easing off gradually. My expectation will be that we'll record some positive growth rate in the last quarter because we've gradually opened up the economy. And quite recently, last quarter of this year, and quite recently, we've seen more opening up of the economy. So with tourism and other things picking up gradually, we are likely to see some growth, positive growth rates. So my anticipation will be for us to grow in the range of 2% on average for 2020. And I'm quite optimistic we may be hovering around that figure.
Well, speaking of economic recovery, accounting and auditing firm KPMG wants an aggressive approach towards the growth of local industries. Senior partner Anthony Sapon believes that it will help the country deal with the impact of disruption in global supply of goods as the COVID-19 pandemic continues to ravage economies. There has been concerns of rising commodity prices due to the surge in COVID-19 cases, forcing many countries to go into further lockdowns. Mr. Sapon says the country needs a refocus on local production.
For Ghanaians, one of the things we need to look out for is creation of inputs. How can we ensure that a lot of the things that we use locally, we are building them up from our local resources, that way to reduce dependence on imports so that in any event that the global supply chain is disrupted, we are not significantly impacted. The second one is the financial intermediation. We are all aware the central bank has begun the journey of creating confidence in the financial services sector. But most importantly, businesses need affordable finances to be able to execute laudable, bankable projects. We want to believe that this government and the central bank will continue to create stable macroeconomic environment and monetary policies such that funds could be available. And in this respect, we are all aware the Minister of Finance has announced a 100 billion project, Obatampa project. That, in my view, should help provide some funds for businesses so that they'll be able to revamp their businesses, expand their scope, and build a sustaining business for the future.
Some more economic news. Ghana's interest payment is projected to hit almost 50% of government revenue this year. That's according to international ratings agency Moody's Sub-Saharan Africa Outlook report. Charles Nixon Yeboah has more.
Interest payment, which is interest paid on loans in 2020, was estimated to have constituted about 32% of government revenue. This actually makes the nation number one in sub-Saharan Africa that spends chunk of its revenue to pay interest on borrowed monies. Spending large revenue to settle interest costs would deprive the nation the needed finance for other socio-economic projects such as schools and hospitals. Moody's said refinancing risk will increase in the coming years, particularly 2024 and 2025, as Eurobond maturities approach. However, Eurobond maturities will be relatively small this year and next year. Ghana first went to the international capital market in 2007 to raise $750 million at a cost of 8.50%. It has since been borrowing funds via the Eurobond. Moody's pointed out that in 2024 and 2025, Ghana alongside Zambia and South Africa will have large Eurobond maturities, and therefore gross borrowing requirements and liquidity risk will remain elevated into the medium term even as the economic recovery continues. The finance ministry had earlier projected that interest payment will fall by nearly 1.6 billion cedis to about 24.7 billion cedis this year.
In other news tonight, an international trade relations expert is upbeat that the Africa Continental Free Trade Agreement will ignite interest of the Joe Biden administration to want to strengthen trade ties with Africa. Mr. Biden was sworn into office as the 45th president of the United States on Wednesday. Now, according to the executive secretary of the Ghana International Trade Commission, Frank Ejekum, considering the current improvement in trade between Ghana and the rest of Africa, it will be in the interest of the United States if Mr. Biden introduced policies that seek to facilitate trade between the U.S. and Africa.
I'd want to believe in such vein, because already President Biden has given indication of its readiness to be more open in dealing with countries such as in Africa. As you did rightly say, he's expected to unblock the ascendancy of the WTO of Nkonjo Iweala of Nigeria, which would be a good thing for Africa. And also, he has indicated his desire for multilateralism, as indicated in his rejoining the Paris Peace Climate Accord and all those stuff. So it does tell you that he's moving in a multilateral direction, which puts in a very good stead, because now we have the Africa Continental Free Trade Area, which will be a good vehicle for us to deal with Biden's multilateral efforts. And for Africa, I think it is good for America and under Biden or whichever president to try and engage Africa, because really Africa has the potential to be a world player. As we do realize in the next few years, by 2021, about half of the world's population will be in Africa. So it does bode well for any president anywhere at all to try and engage Africa on an even keel and try and make sure that the interests of Africa are also sought in the relations, in terms of trade, in terms of whatever beginning is going on, because dealing with about half of the world's population, I mean, a few years from now, is something that should engage the attention of all world leaders.
Let's narrow it down to Ghana. What do you feel must be the priority line when it comes to negotiations with the U.S., this new U.S. administration on trade lines?
Well, there are a myriad of issues that could be put on board. I mean, already Ghana has a very good relationship with America, would seek to up it in all aspects. I mean, there's AGOA, for instance, that has stood us in a very good state. We could reactivate that and see how far we can escalate that, because that gives us access to non-tariff products to the U.S. markets and others. Mm. It also helps our industries to grow and then be able to compete on the international scene. The other areas of escalation, I mean, America is always very interested in terms of security and counterterrorism matters. All these things must be looked at, how we fit into it and how we are able to accommodate it, if we do want to accommodate some of them at all. But in all this, as we did rightly say, it's for Africa to be able to state its claim as to what it wants, how it wants to get it, and be able to negotiate on an even keel and on a basis that will inure to the benefits of Africans and not the benefits of America or whichever country we deal with.
All right. Executive Secretary of GITC speaking there with my colleague Charles Aite on the marketplace. Now, the Ghana Private Road Transport Union is ruling out an immediate increment in transport fares. And now this is despite the significant upward adjustment in prices of petroleum products. But why is the union holding on to any adjustment? George Afe looks into that.
Ghana Private Road Transport Union, GPRT, in responding to our queries, gives several reasons to back its decision not to start engaging government now for an increase in fares. According to the GPRT, the increment by the various oil marketing companies doesn't cross their own established 10% threshold that should push for talks with government for an increase in fares. Now, this is a sharp departure from the previous convention where, if within a quarter, fuel prices should go up by more than 5% together with the increment in other variables like insurance and spare parts that should actually push for an increment in fares. A careful look at the adjustments that have been done over the past few days show that the increment is about 9% based on numbers supplied by analysts. This is 1% shy of the 10% target that the GPRT has set for itself to actually push for talks to increase fares. But the union was actually quick to add that if there are further increases as projected, then they would definitely push for an increment in fares. By that time, the union believes the sector minister should be in office to urge their discussions for adjustment in fares. So for now, we could be excused from any significant increase in the cost of living in the coming days, because the transport operators are not going to increase fares, at least for the next 2 weeks.
Some good news for now. That's Business Live tonight. Thanks for watching. My name is Daryl Kwame.